Cybernetics is a superscience, and yet people know very little about it. Forgotten? Ignored? Mistaken for something else? Perhaps so, but there is no other science that it is directly concerned with answering the why questions. You see, cybernetics is the science that began dealing with purposeful systems. By doing so, it has been able to connect the world of the physical mechanical with the world of the living. It is also the science of getting results and of governance in the widest sense possible. In fact, the word government comes from Kubernetes, the same word used to coin cybernetics. Kubernetes is the man at the helm of a ship, in Greek, of course. In this video, I will build a map of cybernetics and other closely related sciences or fields. Cybernetics stands on its own as a science, and it works in the background for many other sciences. Cybernetics has evolved to become a scientific paradigm, a different way of acquiring and storing knowledge. So, let's start. We all know that we cannot escape the laws of physics. However, not until physics became a science did people start realizing that the whole universe was subject to the same physical laws. Exactly the same thing can be said about cybernetics, except that cybernetics was born and became a science until after World War II. Most of the high-tech gadgets we enjoy come from cybernetics, whether people see the connection or not. Now, it has become a scientific paradigm that encompasses all of traditional science, but not many people are aware of this. This video is not a story about cybernetics, but rather a guide about what it was in the beginning, how it evolved, and what it is now. We begin. The first person to really focus on what later became cybernetics was Arturo Rosenbluth, a Mexican physiologist doing research on homeostasis at Harvard University with Walter Cannon in the late 1930s. A paper by Rosenbluth presented in the 1942 Macy Foundation meeting and a later paper in 1943 with Norbert Wiener and Julian Bigelow called Behavior, Purpose, and Teleology can serve as the genesis for cybernetics. Most impressed with the new area of interdisciplinary research were Warren McCulloch, who was researching neural networks, and Margaret Mead and her husband Gregory Bateson, both social scientists. The core group behind the idea of exploring causal circularity, feedback, and purpose were McCulloch, Rosenbluth, Mead, Bateson, Fremont Smith, and Wiener. The Macy group got together until World War II was over. The world of high-tech we live today is a direct result of this peacetime effort, where some of the most brilliant minds of the past century came together and shared and confronted ideas to give birth to cybernetics. In a parallel and compatible effort, systems thinking and system science were being created by another group of holistic thinkers, led by Ludwig von Bertalanffy, Russell Acuff, C. West Churchman, and others. Participation in the Macy Foundation meetings required mental toughness, given the free-for-all style of discussions. Many egos were shattered, but in the end, every scientist took with him a wealth of knowledge back to his own field of study. It was during the second meeting that John von Neumann presented the design for the very first programmable computer, the ENIAC. He also made comparisons between computer and brain. In this historic second meeting, held in September 1946, Wiener measured information content in terms of bits, zeros, and ones. Information has the same formula as entropy, added Wiener with a negative sign in front. For Wiener's biographers, his presentation marks the birth of the digital age. For the public at large, feedback became synonymous with response, and cyber became the trigger prefix for anything having to do with computers. A total of 10 Macy Foundation meetings on cybernetics were held from 1946 to 1953, all except one in New York City. In total, 70 well-known scientists participated. This is a photograph taken of the attendance to the last reunion in 1953. The first thing to remember about cybernetics is that it was created by the collaboration of many scientists from different fields who later went back to enrich their original areas of interest. This cross-pollination set off the Big Bang of the information age, a bang so loud that cybernetics was lost to all but a few hardliners now entrenched in the American Society for Cybernetics. Given the mess that the world is in, cybernetics is ready to prove that it can make the right questions in order to provide the best answers. Left and right are the names of some of the participants in the Josiah Macy Foundation meetings where cybernetics got its name. The first to use the term cybernetica were Plato and Aristotle, meaning the art of the steersman. Government comes from the word Kubernetes. Cybernetics, simply said, is the science of governance. Systems theory developed as a specific area of study following the World Wars from the work of Ludwig von Bertalanffy, Anatole Rapoport, Kenneth E. Boulding, William Ross Ashby, Margaret Mead, Gregory Bateson, C. West Churchman, and others in the 1950s, specifically catalyzed by the cooperation in the Society for General Systems Research. System theory puts emphasis on structure, while cybernetics puts it on function. However, cybernetics has become far more developed. It can absorb system theory and system science, and not the other way around. Operations research was another important contributor to cybernetics. From now on, I will refer to cybernetics and system science as one and the same thing. Ross Ashby wrote Introduction to Cybernetics in 1956 as an introduction to Wiener's book. It is a gigantic effort that builds cybernetics from scratch as a formal science in the same vein as logic or mathematics. He sets down some of the basic concepts of the new science and says that its truth are not conditional on their being derived from some other branch of science. Ashby invents idealized machines which are the equivalent of the ideal shapes in Euclidean geometry. His book, Introduction to Cybernetics, demonstrates the law of requisite variety, now known as Ashby's Law, and which reasserts itself in real-life control situations in the same way that the law of gravity does in the physical world. Ashby also introduces difference as a key cybernetic concept along with complexity and its scientific name, variety, as the crux of control theory. Cybernetics deals with all forms of behavior insofar as they are regular or determinate or reproducible. Cybernetics offers the hope of providing effective methods for the study of control of systems that are intrinsically extremely complex. It is chiefly when systems become complex that the new methods reveal their power. Cybernetics asks, what are all the possible behaviors this machine can produce? In this way, information theory comes to play an essential part of the subject because it is characterized essentially by its dealing always with a set of possibilities. This period in the 60s allows cybernetics to disperse into many areas of research and the creation of many different theories. It also engulfs previous theories such as information theory, robotics, and automata theory. Artificial intelligence has tried to distance itself from the original field of cybernetics, but history cannot be undone, and the proof of paternity is there between the original science and the ungrateful child. Also in the 60s, plastic surgeon Dr. Maxwell Maltz publishes his book Psycho-Cybernetics, which eventually sells more than 36 million copies worldwide. Considered non-scientific at first, it is later validated by the discovery that the human brain does create mental maps and that these play an important role in determining human behavior. In an indirect fashion, psycho-cybernetics leads to the idea that there is some sort of collective intelligence or knowledge that can be tapped to make the world a better place. Cybernetics is now ripe enough to add studies on self-reference, conversation theory, catastrophe theory, chaos theory, network theory, learning and adaptation theories, ecology, and neuroscience. A group of thinkers and researchers who see themselves as the offspring of the Macy Group and who have more interest in concepts than in hardware have been called the creators of the second cybernetics by Heinz von Forster. Cybernetics is taking science to another level. Now, the observer and the observed are treated as part of the same system. Consequently, the non-linearities and paradoxes of self-reference need to be taken seriously. This group's particular concern is the theory of self-organizing systems. Now, I am adding management cybernetics to our map, showing its connection to all the cybernetics previously accepted. To create management cybernetics, Stafford Beer incorporates ideas from Wiener, Asprey, von Forster, and others. As you can see in the drawing above, Asprey's laws of requisite variety is being incorporated to the viable system model. Stafford Beer defines cybernetics as the science of effective organization. Strange as it sounds, cybernetics is a relativistic science where the observer decides the system being identified. This gives rise to many different definitions of cybernetics according to the different points of view. If you please, pause for a minute to read the definitions. Cybernetics continues to grow to absorb as closely related fields other areas of research, such as the prisoner's dilemma, cellular automata, game theory, complexity science, collective intelligence, evolution, self-organization, homeostasis, attractors, entropy, nonlinear dynamics, emergence, paradox, and self-reference. Related to computers, new areas have arisen: artificial intelligence, artificial neural nets, microchip digital technology, genetic algorithms, web science, computational modeling, e-science, agent-based modeling, and data mining. Management cybernetics can be seen expanding to shelter the new economy, butterfly economics, the cybernetic state, government, law, politics, and economics. Please add astrobiology and molecular biology. After all, galaxies are creators of stars, and these in turn produce heavier than hydrogen elements. This process, from where all life originates, is also a feedback-based process. On this other side, we can add constructivism, biology of cognition, and experimental epistemology. Plus, socio-cybernetics, social systems theory, global network society. Add autopoiesis, reflexivity, and fractal geometry. Add complex adaptive systems, and you broaden the field of cybernetics even more. Cybernetics has evolved to become a scientific paradigm, a different toolbox for building models of complex systems, interpreting data, and acquiring knowledge. So, next time you hear someone mention cybernetics, think of it as a highly interconnected science without well-defined borders, and certainly not a discipline jealously defended by theoreticians and practitioners. Here is another map of cybernetics, showing second-order cybernetics as having to do with observing systems, setting the stage for the two different scientific paradigms, both cybernetic and experimental. Cybernetics has become a paradigm in its own right. It therefore engulfs traditional science as it deals in principle with any observer and the acquisition of knowledge. As a formal science, as presented by W. Ross Ashby, it stands on the same ground as mathematics, logic, geometry, and other abstract sciences, and gives support to all computer-based sciences. Given Ashby's definition of machine, cybernetics covers anything under the sun that shows some sort of behavior, except other formal sciences. From looking at this map, we can make the assertion that cybernetics is the biggest chunk of the apple of knowledge, a superscience.